trucks leaving here and not coming back, and jobs leaving here. You know, when I got into this job, I left a very perfectly cushy, not cushy, but perfectly secure job, not cushy, secure. Wasn't cushy. Hell knows that. A lot of people, I killed off a lot of people not only job when I was a bad guy, but I left the job as very secure because I want my kids not only to grow up here, but I want my kids' kids to grow up here. And unless we create more economic opportunity for people, that's not going to happen. So I can't go to Congress and vote for things that I think are going to be job killers for this area. And that's what I'm concerned about. One of the other things I was very, very concerned about was this mentality that manufacturing jobs are gone and they ain't coming back. And I just don't subscribe to that at all. We've got a great, highly trained and highly educated workforce. We have great universities in this area. And we have unbelievable natural resources here. And we have a hub, and we got infrastructure here from the interstates in all directions. And I look at what's going on in the Southwest right now, where the water situations are so horrible, and they're rationing water, and manufacturing rates are going through the roof. And I think we're trying to get some of those jobs, and get them up here, and put people back to work. And that's what I want. Those are some of the things that drew me into manufacturing. My father, I look at the GM and remind me of that, because he went to manufacturing plants all over New York State. Primarily because he was an industrial engineer. He would help design things to help factories work better. And he told me all the time, and I saw all the time that the factories were here. And they can come back. We got to work hard. And the big thing I think we got to do is level the playing field with our foreign competitors. Okay, we can't have a tax rate for corporations in the United States that's double or triple what it is for our competitors. For example, Canada, their tax rate's half or less. For the manufacturers and money for our manufacturers here. And I have no interest in making manufacturers wealthy, but I have every interest in making individuals have a good standard of living and a good job here. And if you level the playing field, even remotely, I guarantee you that our labor force can kick the crap out of anybody's in the world. You don't have to worry about TPAs and all these trade agreements that give away the store. If we have even a remotely level playing field, they'll be coming to spring for us. And let's not forget one other thing, okay? We represent in the United States 2% of the world's population. 2%. We represent 25% of the world's economy. We are so blessed to live in this country, and we can't forget that. And we can't give away our status as leaders economically, leaders politically, leaders in freedom in this country to anyone. And you know, so from an economic standpoint, I believe that. From an international standpoint, I believe that. That's why I believe your deal with Iran is terrible. It's horrible. And I can talk about that if people are interested. And that's why I believe the way I do on a lot of votes I've taken. And I'm a Republican, okay? But I voted against TPA. I voted to support things about Davis-Bacon when some of my colleagues tried to slip things in. You know, I'm voting for you on the things that I think are important for my constituents in Central New York. And that's why the Teamsters, I'm getting along with them both locally and nationally. And the other unions, Greg Lancet, those guys we're working with, and I'm going to continue to do that, okay? And, you know, I'm going to listen to you folks, and that's why I'm here. And I'll come here as many times as you want to listen to you, okay? So I can go on and on, but quite frankly, I prefer you to fire away at me. I might put me on the firing line, and you can judge me by my answers right off the cuff. So if anybody has any questions, fire away. Yes, sir.
I'm not sure how to phrase this. I know we met with you and you voted against the TPP.
Mm-hmm. TPA.
Well, whatever you want to call it.
Okay. TPP, nobody knows what's in it because it's secret.
All right. Mm-hmm. Right, it's secret.
Yeah.
The voting against the track to fast track.
Right.
It's my understanding, I read somewhere, and I thought, or maybe somebody told me that you voted against that, but then Congressman Boehner sort of skirted the rules a little bit and brought up something to vote, to re-vote for that agreement instead of ending the vote. And you voted to bring back that agreement. Is that correct? Am I correct?
It may have been a technical vote that brought the vote to the floor. And you know, no one ever votes against bringing a vote to the floor.
But no, I'm not talking about the initial vote. I'm talking about the second part of that where he was going to bring it back because it was defeated.
I voted against it. Again.
In this,
yes.
For that agreement.
I voted against the TPA.
But did you vote against his attempt to bring back the voting for or against the agreement.
Well, they brought it, they brought the vote back in the Senate.
Right.
I can't remember the convoluted process because it hooked up something else. But there's, from a procedural standpoint, I have no problem bringing a vote to the floor. But when the substance of the vote is what it is, that's what's important to me. So I can't remember if I did or not vote for the procedural thing to bring it up for a vote the second time, but
I think you voted to bring it up. That's what concerns me because it should have ended there.
No, because you know the thing about it, you got to vote on the substance of it. The substance of it is, are you for it or against it? Clearly, I'm against it. My record's clear. And 22 times in a row, voted against it. Make it, but originally, when we came up in the House, and the second time they came back in the Senate, both times they said no. And that was one of a very few handful of Republicans voting against it. And I'm very proud to say that because I stood up for what
about
I believe.
About 35, 36 of them. But
right.
You did vote to bring it back to.
From a procedural standpoint, I may have, but quite frankly, I don't even remember.
Okay.
Yeah, because I just know the substance of it as well as the body. So, yes?
Can you name me one corporation that pays full corporate taxes?
I know GE doesn't pay a damn thing.
Neither does ExxonMobil,
right.
Neither does Dell, even does
Mobil. Right, and here's one thing, I have a problem with that. Here's when I say, you know, level the playing field for manufacturers, that I would only level the playing field for manufacturers so you can compete internationally if the bigger companies, right, got rid of the loopholes. I mean, get rid of the loopholes that those companies benefit from. So everybody pays their fair share. That's what we should do in America, right? And I said this during the campaign, and I'll say this to you today. I think that we need a tax code where the most important person is the guy working the second shift at Chrysler, as opposed to some fancy pants jackass in the corporate boardroom that's a tax accountant. Okay? Those are the guys, that's the problem with our tax code. It's too complicated, there's too many loopholes, there's too many openings. Simplify the tax code, get rid of the loopholes, and as an incentive to get rid of the loopholes, lower the marginal tax rate. That way, everyone's paying their fair share. People have a perception. Pardon me?
How about the capital gains?
Well, that's an investor-driven thing. That's a little different. I'm talking about businesses first here. I mean, businesses first.
Small businesses pay their portion of taxes, but corporations do not.
Right, and that's not right. I totally agree with you. I absolutely agree with you. And that's part of what they're doing. They're talking about overall tax reform that Paul Ryan's working on, is trying to close those. And I tell you, I'm not going to vote for it.
I suggest very strongly you look very detailed at Mr. Ryan.
Oh, I am. Trust me, believe me. Because he was a main proponent of TPA. Okay, so I told him no way. Right off the bat. It's not those little freshman congressmen. I said no. And he had to deal with it. I said, tough shit. And I never wavered from that. And looking at he's not kidding. So, and I had a lot of pressure on me, trust me. But the bottom line is you're right. You can't have tax reform in the United States without closing the corporate loopholes. Period. Without it, it's not fair. Yes?
Not really a question, just an interjection. I agree with what you're saying. However, it isn't, poor people don't write the tax code. That tax code was written by these corporate people for corporate people. I mean,
exactly.
Nobody in this room had any input into those loopholes.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you going to fight them on that when it comes to trying to get rid of these tax loopholes that was created by them for them?
Well, the same way I did with TPA and the same way I did with other votes in Congress that weren't popular for my party. I stand for what I believe in. You know, I'm one of those guys. I'm not a rich guy. My father would leave on a Monday morning, come back on a Friday night. He traveled all over New York State. He had one car for seven kids. Vacations were awesome, but it was crazy. But and you know, we were you know, blue collar as far as I'm concerned growing up. And you know, we wanted stuff in high school. We went out and got jobs as kids. Okay, so that's how I was born and brought up. You know, and that's what I believe in. I gave away any chance of wealth a long time ago for public service 23 years ago. So it's guys like me in Congress. There's more than you think. Okay, and you know, you're right. There's special interests in Congress to look out for their interests, but there's also special interests in Congress looking out for your interests. Guys like this come down and talk to me, and guys like Greg, and they tell me what they think. And we listen to that too, because my constituency here in Central New York is not a bunch of fat cats. My constituency is you guys. And that's why I have to listen to it.
And I think you're sincere. My thing is looking at the big picture. No, I'm just looking at the big picture. Because that's not true for everybody in Washington that, you know, to have that. I'm just skeptical that these corporations are going to go easily.
Oh, it's why you should be.
All
you should be skeptical. skeptical. You should be skeptical.
You
should be skeptical, and that's good, and I am too. And, you know, there's more people like me in Congress than you might imagine. And we're fed up with hearing some corporations getting, you know, why is it that one corporation here has a better tax law than this corporation, exact same one, is doing much better? That's not what it should be about, right?
Right.
It should be, pay your fair share, get as low as possible so we can compete as we can internationally, with the idea of you guys getting the jobs. That's what I believe. Yeah.
Is anyone in Congress writing new tax codes that would level the playing field?
Yeah, that's what they're working on as part of the comprehensive tax reform, is a simplification of the rules. You know, one of the things they want to do, they want to take the IRS out of the game. The IRS is just a behemoth that's a mess. And if you simplify the tax code, IRS becomes much less relevant. And that, I think that's important from a tax raising standpoint. But basically, get back to what they should have been, just collecting revenue, not what they're doing now.
You think it's actually a possibility?
I think there's enough momentum on both sides of the fence for that. I mean, you're going to give it a try. Yes.
Are you going to get a tax-free status for the overseas money to come back into this country with no penalties?
No, I don't. What they're trying to do is they're trying to repatriate those assets for things like a highway bill. And
like last time, all that guaranteed money was supposed to go into all these jobs were supposed to create during George Bush's administration. Mm-hmm. Not one dime.
but I think you're right. And they look at it as a pot of money. There's no question about it. But if it's specifically dedicated to highway fund, that's, you know,
not
going
to happen.
Well, many things I'm not. But here's the deal. You know, I understand you being a skeptic. That's good to be skeptical. But let me tell you about, like, for example, the discussion on that issue is possibly taking it back. It's a one-time deal to fund the highway bill for 4 to 6 years. Now, hang on a second. Hang on. I know you're skeptical, but just hang on. If it funded it for 4 to 6 years, we got the money back, it created jobs, we could get the IU want to be built where we want to.
There's trillions overseas.
Yes.
They won't even tell you how many trillions are overseas, and it's only going to fund the highway? Please. You could get this country out of debt like in a heartbeat.
Well, I think the bottom line is to answer the question. They're looking at it, you know, and they are, there is ideas of dedicating specifically for the highway and some other things. How much there is, you hear all different kinds of things, okay? Mm-hmm.